Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. Today, I'll show you how to make an MMO server massively scalable. Last week, I added chickens to the game. I was intending to keep working towards adding aggressive mobs and a combat system to the game, but I was going to be developing a whole lot of client-side code that would later need to be ported to the server. So I've decided instead to return to working on the server for now. Before I get started, I want to quickly address a number of comments pointing out that the chicken looks out of place. Rest assured, the chicken is only a placeholder. One of the reasons I release this devlog weekly is to keep myself moving forward. It helps push me on whenever I get stuck on something. Now that I have a better understanding of how to control mobs in Unity, it'll be pretty easy for me to swap in a more appropriate model. That said, I did run out of time this week, so today's episode is going to be part one in what I expect to be a two-part series. In this episode, I'll mostly cover the theory of scalable services. I'll show you how I got a start on one of my microservices, but most of the implementation will be left to next week's episode. It will be a slightly longer and much more technical episode than normal, but hopefully you'll come away with a bit more of an understanding about why I want my server to be built with a microservice architecture rather than it being a sharded monolith. I'll do my best to keep the visuals compelling, but may end up having to splice in footage of a flock of giant high-res chickens chasing the player if I run out of ideas. I'm firstly going to recap where my server is currently at. I'll then go over some microservice theory, then I'll tell you how I'm structuring my microservices. Finally, I'll start breaking out the UDP session management into its own microservice. There won't be a demo of any sort this week, but I strongly recommend watching this episode through before next week's episode, because it's going to lay a lot of theoretical groundwork and hopefully answer a lot of why and why not questions that are likely to come up next week. So let's look at the current state of the server. It's implemented in TypeScript, running on Node.js. When a client wants to connect, it calls an HTTP endpoint, which generates some session parameters that get returned to the client. Most importantly, the UDP endpoint and a session ID. The client then transmits the character's position on every frame. The server runs a tick every 100 milliseconds, which then broadcasts all the connected character positions out to every connected client. There's also a bit of cleanup code that checks for stale sessions, since UDP is stateless, and we don't want to keep sending updates to clients that have disappeared. If you want more details about the current server, there's a card on the screen now, if I remember, for episode 8, where I originally developed it. While I'm very new to game development, I have a fair bit of experience in cloud architecture, having built some pretty large systems using both microservice and monolithic architectures over the years. So I want to quickly share some of the architectural side of things with you before getting into the details of how I'm structuring this game server. Traditionally, services have been built as monolithic systems. Clients connect to a single instance of the server, which itself connects to a database. You scale the system horizontally by having multiple copies of the server, also called sharding, where each server either stores a copy of all the state or becomes responsible for a subset of the system state. MMOs have traditionally used this approach because it's pretty easy to implement. They partition their data based on either game world coordinates or some concept of zone. Each of the servers runs identical software. They rarely talk to each other, except to hand sessions off to each other as players or other entities move around the world. It comes with a number of other technical advantages, like high cache utilization. Since each server owns any data that passes through it, it can cache data pretty much indefinitely and know that its caches will always be valid. The servers are also intrinsically local from a game world perspective. That is, if they own a piece of data, they also tend to own data that exists nearby in the game world. Since most in-game interactions tend to be local, this reduces the amount of internal server-to-server communication needed. That makes it a slam dunk for sharded monolithic architecture, right? Well, not so fast. It comes with some pretty big disadvantages too. First, there are reliability issues with monolithic architecture. Whenever some server resource gets starved, which it's safe to assume will always happen eventually, the entire shard is likely to go down, and those players connecting to that shard will have to wait for the shard to recover or reboot. There are also scalability issues with monolithic architecture. Unless the system is somehow dynamically distributing load between servers, it can be really hard to plan for scalability. Each shard needs to be specced to handle its maximum load, which means you are wasting resources any time a shard is not at capacity, and you'll see poor performance any time a shard is beyond its capacity. Under microservice architecture, you instead strive to minimize both the scope and the state of each of your services. You can think of them as being like packages within a monolithic server. Just as you should strive to write classes and functions that have a single responsibility, microservices should have a single responsibility too. For a game, you might have a single service managing logins, you have one managing input, and another output. If a separate service manages a trade mechanic, and something goes wrong with the trading system, then it only takes out the trading mechanic. The rest of the game continues along just fine. This is not to say that services don't depend on each other, they will. But if you make services resilient to their dependencies going down, you'll end up with a more reliable system. By embracing minimal state, you also end up being able to very quickly spin up more resources as needed. If your entities and their components are held in a distributed data store, then it's easy to spin up more capacity if the load is getting too high. Since no one shard is responsible for any piece of data, it's easier to spread the load between nodes. I also want to quickly talk about an approach to game architecture called ECS. Most of you will be familiar with the Unity approach to component management, where a game is stored as a hierarchy of game objects. Each of those objects has a transform and can have other components attached to it. A component might hold some relevant data about the object and code to define the behavior of that component. ECS, or Entity Component System Architecture, is an alternative way of structuring things. Under ECS, entities are like game objects. They're just collections of components. Components, on the other hand, are just collections of data without any logic behind them. Systems are where the logic of the game live. Each system is responsible for a single facet of the game. It'll typically scan for components meeting its requirements on each frame or tick and apply its logic to that component. While I have no experience working with ECS, I have worked a lot with data-oriented design, which ECS is based on. It excels where you have lots of little bits of data that frequently have the same logic applied to them, one after the other. While there'd be little to no benefit in using ECS in my game client, it is an absolutely perfect fit on the server side, given the main role of the server is to update the state of all the game objects across the entire world on every tick. So, getting back to microservices, what infrastructure do you need to implement them? Each service is going to need a data store. Just like with monolithic architectures, the data store is responsible for persistence of data and querying of that data. To ensure that data stores are rapidly scalable, you probably want to avoid relational databases when you can, as it's much easier to scale a key value or document store horizontally than it is to scale a relational database. You'll want your microservices to cache data to reduce load on your data stores too. But since any request can be handled by any instance of a given microservice, you'll want your services to share distributed caches. And lastly, you'll want a way for your microservices to communicate with each other and distribute work amongst themselves. So you'll want some kind of RPC, remote procedure call mechanism, and a distributed queue or PubSub mechanism. For now, I'm going to use MongoDB for my data stores. I'll use Redis for both my caches and my queues, and I'll use HTTP for my remote procedure calls. So what will my architecture look like? I'll have a session management service responsible for accepting new sessions from clients and managing those sessions. I'll have a terrain service responsible for providing chunk and voxel data to the clients. I'll have an entity component service responsible for holding the state of all the entities in the game and later querying those entities based on their components. I'll have a UDP receiver service responsible for receiving packets from the clients and dishing requests out to other services. I'll have a UDP transmitter service responsible for sending world updates back out to the client. Then further game logic will be implemented as separate services. There'll probably be an entity lifecycle service to handle crafting and spawning. There'll be an AI service to control mobs, and so on. The last bit of theory I want to cover is my protocols. Previously, the client and server just sent JSON to each other. The client sent a blob with a session ID in it, and the server sent back JSON datagrams with a list of all the entity positions. I want to start sending a bit more data about entities now, so I want to formalize the protocol a bit more. My packets will have a header. In it, there'll be a control word, the session ID, then a hash, which I'll explain in a bit. The header will be followed by a compressed protobuf stream, encrypted with the session's secret token. The control word will contain protocol version information. The hash will be a CRC of the raw, unencrypted, uncompressed protobuf streams. To validate a packet, the UDP receiver will look up the session token from the session service to check its validity and get its secret token. It will then decrypt and decompress the payload before verifying the hash. In order to spoof the packet, you would need to know both the target session ID and secret token. You can't even inject random data into someone else's session because there's no way you could fake the hash of the unencrypted data. The only information that can be gleaned from sniffing packets is the session ID and roughly how much data is being sent back and forth. When sending UDP packets, you're normally limited to about 1 to 1.5 kilobytes of data in a packet. Otherwise, the packet gets silently dropped. So when sending data, the sender should keep pushing data into a compressed send buffer. Once it's almost full, the sender needs to transmit what it has before starting to form the next packet. UDP is also unreliable, so it needs to keep sending that same data until the client has acknowledged receipt. Once too much data needs to be transmitted though, there's a point where it might as well just give up, tell the client their copy of the data is invalid, and they should go fetch the data through some other, more reliable means. There's no benefit to UDP once things start getting congested, so you might as well start falling back to something else. While I won't get all of that covered even next week, I'll make sure the protocol gets to a point where it supports all of these features. It was time to start implementing some microservices to replace existing functionality. While I'm holding off most of the implementation until next week's episode, I thought it would be useful to show how a single microservice was put together. So I'll show you the Session Manager service. Sessions are transient by their very nature, so I decided not to use a persistent store for this one. It will instead just store session information in a shared cache. If the session data gets lost, clients will just re-establish their sessions and the system will automatically recover. I'll use Express.js and Redis for this one. Given I plan to actually deploy this service to the cloud soon, I decided to cut down a bit on the hackery. I started with some boilerplate to make the service a bit more secure and easier to manage. I brought in Helmet, which applies some security best practices to the service, and a logging framework. I want the logging framework to behave a bit differently between development and production, so I also brought in a configuration library called .env. This will let me more easily configure the logging library to talk out to external management systems when in production, rather than logging to the console. I also needed some management code to let future management systems detect node health and terminate unhealthy or underutilized nodes. I broke the existing session management code out into a controller. We need admin endpoints to let us see and manipulate the internal state of the system, and for the clients to establish new sessions. The UDP receiver service was going to need to be able to access and update session state, and the UDP transmitter service was going to need a way of enumerating and distributing sessions between their nodes. So I put in dummy endpoints for all of that. I defined some basic authorization functions. While they are just dummy functions that permit all requests for now, they work well as documentation until I implement request tokens. These functions will get factored out into a common module next week, since all my services will need them. It was now time to implement the logic behind the controllers. I did this in a new service layer. I wrote a CRUD or create, read, update, delete service for the sessions themselves and hooked the relevant controller handlers up to it. I created a Redis client service that just stores the session objects as JSON blobs in Redis, accessible with their session ID. This is all pretty straightforward at this point and probably no different to the monolithic approach. Next, I needed to write the code to support distributing sessions out to each UDP transmitter on each tick. This is a bit more involved since there could be multiple UDP receivers or even multiple instances of this session management service. The naive approach would be to have some sort of a distributed lock to ensure only one instance is able to replicate the list of sessions to be serviced on each tick. But locks are slow, clunky, and incredibly difficult to reason about in a distributed system. Far better is to embrace a bit of chaos and make the system as a whole resilient to data being processed multiple times. If we just ignore the compulsion to use a lock, the worst thing that might happen is we might process some sessions multiple times per tick. In the event the UDP transmitter doesn't detect the duplication, we may end up sending multiple datagrams to the client, and the contents of these duplicates may even differ slightly. But as long as the client only ever processes a single packet for each tick, it will only ever acknowledge a single packet for each tick, and the system will get back in sync. This is the key to writing distributed systems. It's not possible to guarantee exactly once delivery of a message in a distributed system. It's easy to guarantee at least once delivery, on the other hand. So embracing that makes your services simpler and more performant. So I implemented the session distribution code. When a request comes in for a tick, if we have previously generated work to do for that tick, then we pass some of that work back to the client. Otherwise, we first duplicate the list of sessions. If two or more initial requests come in at the same time, they may both end up generating the session tick queue, resulting in some items being processed multiple times. With that done, I had all my tests passing, and it was time to move on to more services, which we'll get to next week. I expect to finish off this refactor in the next episode and be able to deploy the server to the cloud. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss it. If you want to binge the whole series to date, click here or here to watch what the algorithm thinks you might want to see next. And until next time, happy game developing.